life, and I know sometimes we want to speed everything up. It's kind of like courting somebody, right? We couldn't wait to get married, you know? And I guess it was 4 years, right? We were figuring it out. I don't know. We were talking there not that long ago. But, you know, when we were first dating, it was like, well, you know, you always want to get married, like, in the first 3 months. But, you know, you take that time, and it's a growing process. It's in a curve. And it's something that begins to change your life and develop a depth in you that gives you strength to move forward. God is developing something in your life today that even though you want to get off the table, even though you want to say, I don't want the surgery anymore, even though you say, I just got to have the victory because I want it now, hang in there. Those roots are going down deep, and you're going to go great places for God. But these 400 men ended up in a cave, and they were in debt, discouraged, and broke, and unhappy, and dissatisfied, and complaining. How many know that that's probably one of the first things you can do in your life is to get away from 400 people that are going to pull you away? At some point, you've got to make a decision to say, you know what? I'm not going to go that route because that route is going to keep me. They'd still be in the cave. Don't allow your life to stay in the cave. Begin to break forth. You know, I was you know, and it's hard. Sometimes I feel guilty talking about my kids because they're just a true blessing to me. And just to see some of the decisions and some of the things where they make those decisions as godly character. And they get that from their mom. And they make them, and hopefully from their dad. But to make those godly decisions and say, you know what, I'm doing this. The crowd might be going that way. But by the way, crowd, I'm going that way. And so when you see that, it's so exciting because that's allowing their roots to grow down deep. One of the neat ways that I taught Carly on how there's no pleasure in drinking. Do you know how we taught her that? I said, you act like an absolute nut bar like your dad, and you have so much fun, you don't need anything to loosen your life up. You just go and be the life of the party anyway, and you'll save a lot of money. Amen? You'll save a lot of money, a lot of money. And so you could do that. But it's so neat to see decisions that are moving toward God, not decisions that are moving away from God. And as you begin to allow your roots to go down deep, it will tap into the source. Last year, the whole reason why Josh and I were on a little day trip yesterday was we were going to a place, actually to the Tim Horton camp, and we were able to purchase some baled corn stalks to feed cows. Okay? Corn stalks is stuff that you throw away. But you know what? Through this time, we have learned to improvise. We have learned to adapt. We have learned to make it work. And so as we were talking about why are we going to do this, it's causing my roots to go down deeper and to know how do you survive in dangerous times. Do you know what it also showed me? That in times of drought, it causes the roots of a crop, because the corn crop actually was pretty good. Those roots will go down and find water. And so up on the ground, I know we're looking forward to July, but when it's 135 degrees and it feels like life is just really, really hot and you're looking for air conditioning, those roots that have went through the drought, they have found ways into the earth. They've found cracks and crevices and they've tapped into a water source and they will sit there and grow and grow and grow. That's why you'll have people with really nice green lawns, because their root system have found that there is a root system that's went down to where the water source is. And so even up above, the storm may go and the sun may be there and it might be scorching, but if they've tapped into that root system of water, they will continue to thrive and survive. Your life needs to be the same way. We've got to stop making Christianity difficult. We've got to begin to look at life and say, wait a second, what is it that I need to do to be able to get to the next level? What is it that I need to do to get to the next step? And so let's do that. So these guys were all in the cave. They were whining, complaining. They weren't getting anywhere. But we know that God says victory is something that God has for you. Fellowship puts you in a position of victory. That's why the word says, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Why is it important to go to church? Let's think about that. The scripture says, do not forsake yourself, the assembling of yourselves together. Okay? You'll run into a lot of Christians now. We all know Christians that go, well, I didn't like church because, you know, it's Carl or because it's this or because it's that. We've all heard the stories. But the bottom line is the word says, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves. Do you know why? Because as I've said before, you need assembling. Coming together, we all glean and learn and help one another. You rub off on one another. You encourage one another. You build up on one another. When you say, well, I'm just going to do it all by myself, you can do that. But if you've ever noticed, you have a real hard time doing it all by yourself. When you are around people of like faith, you're not going to behave like 400 men in a cave. If you had 400 people in a cave praising God, you'd all say, praise God, we can do this thing. We can knock the side out of the mountain. We can move forward because we've assembled ourselves. So don't forsake that, okay? fellowship with people that are going to put you in a position of victory. Now, Psalm 1. We want to go there. Psalm 1. Great scripture. Praise the Lord. It says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. You know, sometimes Carly's favorite thing, and it blesses me, and it's Hannah's favorite thing too. She loves to go through my Facebook, and she blocks my friends. Like, you don't need that friend, and you don't need that friend. And she loves that. It's all right. It's okay. Because you know what? There are some really silly things people can put on. And she blocks and says, you don't need that, Dad. And one time I said, well, how come this certain person is gone now? You know, I didn't know. And they always get this funny little smirk on their face, and I know they've been in there. But it's okay, you know. And so it says, blessed is the man. I've been trying to talk them, letting Vicky come back on Facebook. But anyway, blessed is the man. I'm kidding. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. You got to decide who your friends are. You got to decide who is going to cause you to move forward in God. And you know what? I'm really social, so sometimes I have a really hard time with that. But I can remember when it felt like I hung out with the dirty dozen. And all it does is, you know, even, you know, and sometimes we'll make excuses, well, this is my area of ministry. Well, that can be your area of ministry, but if you're not careful, it can be your area of downfall. And so I'm not asking you to exit the world, because we need to be salt and light in the world. You need to catch that, okay? You need to be careful. But you need to know when is a healthy thing and when is something that's not healthy. You need wisdom on that, okay? But it says here, blessed is the man who doesn't walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. And the scornful can just be people that maybe don't want to believe in victory for you. You're going to run into Christians that maybe say, you know what, this faith thing doesn't work. What do you mean believe in God for your family? You know, what do you mean believe in God for healing? What do you mean believe in God for your finances? 400 men in a cave were all talking scornful. They were in debt. They were in distress. They were just really, really, really not enjoying themselves. So you want to be careful that people are going to pull you forward. I love one of the things that I'm not going to talk about Facebook anymore, but I love to find faith-filled ministries, and I like them. You know why? Because they come up on my phone all the time, and I'll get a little phrase from a Joel Osteen or a John Hagee or somebody that'll be something that'll just go, you know what? That's like a power punch for your day. And just begin to surround yourself with people that are going to encourage you and say, God is on your side. You can believe for healing. You can believe for your miracle, because God wants to see you move forward. And then it says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in this law he meditates day and night. How many know that's, you know, we've heard that 1,000 times. We've heard it from the beginning of time since you got saved. Meditate on the word. Okay, we know, Pastor, it means to mutter. It means to think about. You know what it means? It's your fear moving backwards. You can be fearful real easy. You think about something, you know, about, you know, you could think about, well, we've never made a habit of locking our doors, and we should, okay? But the other night, coming home from Bible study, there was a gentleman walking up the highway in the middle of the night, or whatever, I don't know, 10 o'clock or something, and it was dark, and suddenly it was like the enemy was right there. And he said, oh, you need to be fearful. How is your family? You're not home yet. Are they safe, you know? And so I took that fear, though, but I took wisdom from that and said, maybe we need to start locking our doors. We need to be wise, okay? We need to be smart about those things. I used to leave keys in the cars all the time because I thought, well, who's going to want a car way out here, you know? But you need to be wise, and so you can use those things. But you don't want to get over into fear. But if you feed your fear, that's something that you'll think about over and over and over again. And when you're done thinking, you'll rewind it, and you'll talk about it again, and you'll think about it again, and you'll phone 5 friends and talk about it again. And before you know it, you are spinning out of control. Take that same recipe, though, and turn it into faith. And find a scripture that does the opposite of what you just said. And think about that. And talk about that. And have faith about that. And what I'm saying is the thing that you fear, find the scripture that brings faith and start thinking about that. See your family as safe. See your doors locked. See the keys out of your ignition. See your kids growing up and getting married. See your family is having victory in some area. See yourselves at a celebration party 10 years from now. What I'm trying to say is it creates a vision of victory in your life. Because otherwise you're creating a vision of fear. Because we could all stop right now and have a vision of fear. And I will be the first one to suggest that I can really wrestle with those things. If the vet comes out to look at an animal, I've got 900 visions of fear. I remember when Boz, and Mark, you might have a hard time hearing this, but I remember when I thought Boz had cancer. And I was so panicked. And it was, you know, and I was like, oh my goodness, there's a huge lump and he's got cancer. And what am I going to do? And then, you know, and I remember taking him to the vet and I was so afraid. You know what the vet said to me? He's got to go pee. That's a true story. That's a true story. Now, he gets like this lump whenever he's been holding his bladder for a long time. But I remember it's cancer and it's this and it's a big cyst and we've got to have it removed. And he's thankful we didn't remove it because he just had to go pee. But the point is this, the enemy will magnify things in your life. And if you allow it to do it, it will grow bigger and bigger and bigger until you yourself will move into that cave. You yourself will end up with 400 friends that are all in the same cave saying, we can't do it, we're broke, we're going backwards, it's never going to work, it's not going to happen. And God says, wait a second here. Just take that same recipe, but reverse it. And say, this is an opportunity for me to begin to find that scripture that says, my God's going to supply my need. This is a scripture for me that says, God is going to begin to cause my faith to speak to those mountains and say, they're going to be removed in Jesus' name. This is going to begin to speak to you and say, it's my God that promotes. You don't promote, God promotes you. Doesn't the word say the steps of a good man are ordered of the Lord?
Amen.
So begin to think about that. Now that's meditation. See, we can meditate really good on all of the negative things. It's super easy. So think about those meditations, all right? Put the food away. Think about the meditations in your life. I'm kidding. Think about the things in your life that you're meditating on that are negative, that cause you to say, oh, I can't go to work anymore. They don't like me at work anymore. I can't go. Or I can't go to the shopping mall because every time I go to the shopping mall, I begin to see things that I want and then I can't have them and I have no money. And those things drag you down. Begin to say, wait a second here. Celebrate small victories. Celebrate those small victories and say, wait a minute, I can come through. I can have breakthrough. I can do this. Focus on the thing that you do right, not on the thing that you do wrong, and then begin to move from there. So it says here, here's the tree thing. He will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Rivers of water. Do you know sumacs are the most frustrating thing to a farmer? Do you know willow trees are the most frustrating things to a farmer? Willow trees are those great big trees. They got all the little wee leaves and they're huge, like big, big bushy trees. And they go right down to the ground, okay? Those suckers will grow because they will tap into water and they will find water wherever they need to find water and they will grow. And they will grow and they will grow and they will grow. And when you try and get rid of them, they will grow back again, okay? Because they've tapped into the source. So take a silly little analogy like that, and God is saying to you, you find the source, wherever that source is. If it's 22 minutes with Joel Osteen at 7 o'clock in the morning, then that's your source. Tap into that and take that scripture and learn and grow. If you want to go to YouTube or Facebook and rewatch this sermon, then go and tap into that. If you want to watch an hour of Creflo, then tap into that. If you want to watch T.D. Jakes, then tap into that. But the point is this. Tap into the Word of God because it will move you and cause you to have life on the inside. Amen. Now guess what? The trees that don't have the benefit of tapping into the water, they shrivel up and die.
Yes.
They shrivel up and die. I remember when my mom and dad first built their house, they planted an obscene amount of evergreens. And I remember with 5-gallon pails going and watering every day. We had a dry summer that year, and it was over and over and over and over again to the point that it was frustrating. It's better, let's just let them die. It's easy then, we just cut grass, okay? But we didn't, and now they're super tall. They're probably 20-plus feet tall. They're great big things, and it didn't even take that long. Your breakthrough will not take as long as you think if you tap into God as the source. Your breakthrough will not take as long as you think if you begin to say, you know what, I'm going to start to be happy about the situation that I'm in. I'm going to be happy, 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 okay, about the situation that I'm in. I'm going to begin to say, God is causing me to move forward. And I'm going to begin to say, my family is moving forward and my finances are moving forward. And my, you know, whether it's your job or your health, begin to speak to your body every day. Go look in that mirror. If you need to put a little scripture up on that mirror and read that scripture and say, my God causes all grace to abound toward me. Let's just say you got a real sin problem. Because if you're like a normal person, you probably do, right? And you'll begin to go, oh man, I got so much condemnation. I'm blowing it there. And I talked mean to my daughter, and I wasn't nice to my wife, and I